and for 10 mothers to be 20,000 naira. And that's just the leader, you know, talking compassionately. You know, he doesn't know your boss. You know, you can give 100,000 naira. You know, you can give 500,000 naira. You know, you can give 1,000,000 naira. Because the leader is mentioning 20,000 naira, doesn't mean that you lower yourself, belittle yourself, and then come so low and give 20,000, where you can give 1,000,000. Or maybe in the various countries, you know, your leader might stand up and say, all that is required, just do your best, and you just sort of give the $50, and then once you're giving the $50, that is great. And you know, you can give maybe $200, or you can give $1,000. You're not going to limit yourself to $50 just because your pastor, your leader, is mentioning just a small amount. Well, he has mentioned that small amount so that he can bring the level to the hurdle to a level that everybody can jump, so that you'll not say it's too high, I cannot jump. Those who don't have much, that's the minimum the leaders are going to tell you. But those who have, we're going to give. And when you give, the Lord will multiply what you're giving in Jesus' name. Give me a great amen. I want you to look at this Ezra. I've not finished with Ezra. Ezra chapter 7 verse 23. Whatsoever is commanded by the Lord, by the God of heaven, let it be diligently done for the house of the Lord, of the God of heaven. Whatsoever is commanded, as our leaders will be talking to us, this is what is commanded, this is what is expected. Let everyone then rise up and do what ought to be done. And you know something, as we're looking at Ezra, after we started with doctrine, we started with teaching, and we started with searching the word of God, so that we can be strong in character and strong in discipleship, and then we go to building. But when we finish building, we go back to teaching the word of God again in verse 25. Thou, Ezra, after the wisdom of thy God that is in thine heart, set the magistrates and the judges which may judge all the people that are beyond the river, all such as know the laws of thy God, and teach ye them that know them not. Now that doesn't mean that, you know, as we are now talking on building, when we finish the building, then only building, we continue the teaching. And that's what we find, that's the pattern we find in Ezra here, and we're going to follow that same pattern, and the Lord is going to bless every one of us in Jesus' name. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 9. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, we're reading from verse 7. 2 Corinthians, reading chapter 9 and verse 7. In this passage of scripture in the New Testament, here is the word of the Lord for us. Every man according as he purposes in his heart. You must have a purpose. This is what I am going to give. And the Holy Ghost will be the one reminding you. Didn't you make a purpose, a decision, a determination, a vow, a consecration? This is what I'm going to give. And is it 20,000 naira? And you're going to give all together? Is it 50,000? Is it 100,000 naira? Is it 1,000,000 naira? Or is it $50 or $100 or $500, $1,000? What is it? You have a purpose. And you say, this is what I'm going to give. And I'm going to spread what I'm going to give over the next month. And then you are going to be giving every load. So you don't mix it with your tithes and offering. Your tithes and offering, you still pay. You still give. Because that's your normal duty. This one is a special thing that you are doing. Because you are giving that in the envelope, and you write at the back of the envelope, this is for building the headquarters church, Bagada, Lagos. And then it comes to Lagos. And then those of us who are leaders, and you are collecting all that, want to be faithful to the Lord. That what is given purposefully, directly, to the building of the church, the headquarters church here, you are not diverting. You are not saying, this is too much for headquarters. What do you think can ever be too much for the headquarters? Is this not your headquarters? Nothing is too much for your head. And the Lord will bless you in Jesus' name. You have a purpose in your heart. You have a decision. And you're going to follow through that decision. And every month, you remember, that's my purpose. Every month, you remember, that's my purpose. Until we're finished. Verse 7 again. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. Every man according as the purposes in his heart. So let him give, not grudgingly, or of necessity. For God loveth a cheerful giver. God loveth a cheerful giver. What's going to be the result? What's going to be the blessing upon you if you give? The Lord is about to change your destiny. in Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Luke chapter 6, verse 38. It says, give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. If you give at this time, you're going to be rewarded in a wonderful way in Jesus' name. Good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet with that, it shall be measured to you again. It shall be measured to you again. The Lord will bless you abundantly in Jesus' name. We've seen the pattern in the Word of God, and we're going to follow that pattern. We'll be teaching the Word of God, building up your spiritual lives. Now it is time to build a sanctuary, the headquarters church, and the Lord will help us to get through. I come to point number 3, the pillars of profitable teaching in church establishment. The pillars of profitable teaching in church establishment. We'll come back to Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. As we look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 16, there is a beautiful pattern that we see there. Verses 4 and 5. And as they went through the cities, they delivered them the decrees for to keep that were ordained of the apostles and the elders which were at Jerusalem. And so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number daily. And you see what Paul the apostle did? They have been in Jerusalem. That's at the headquarters church. And as they were at the headquarters church, the headquarters decided something. And then they wrote that down. And then as Paul the apostle with Timothy and the others with his team, as they went from city to city, from church to church, they didn't give them any opinion of their own mind. They gave them the word of God, which had been given to them at the headquarters in Jerusalem. And in fact, they called those words, they called it by particular name. They called it decrees. Look at verse 4 again. And as they went through the cities, they delivered them the decrees for to keep. The word of God that you have heard, that you are hearing here, as we hear it at the headquarters, we take it to their fellowship. It's like a decree. We don't change it. We don't modify it. And we don't alter it. You take it to the zone. You take it to the district. Take it to your group. And we don't change it. And then we hear it from the headquarters. We take it to the states in Nigeria here. We take that same word to all the nations in Africa and beyond Africa. And we don't alter it. And we don't change it. And we don't modify it. We don't say, well, this is a different culture. These are different kinds of people. These are not Nigerians. Because they are not Nigerians, we cannot be preaching the same thing. They are preaching at the headquarters. We give it as a decree unto them, and then we are told that the result of it is that the churches were established and they increase in number daily. I want you to see Acts of the Apostles chapter 15. Acts chapter 15, when it says they took that word away from Jerusalem and they took it like a decree going to the people. Acts chapter 16 verse 22. Then pleased the apostles and the elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company to Antioch, with Paul and Barnabas, namely Judas, surnamed Barsabbas, and Silas, the chief men among the brethren. And they wrote letters by them. After this manner, the apostles and the elders and the brethren sent greetings unto the brethren, which are the Gentiles in Antioch and Syria and Cilicia, for as much as we have heard that certain which went out from us are troubled you with words of butting your souls and saying, ye must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandment. It seemed good unto us, and being assembled with one accord, to send chosen men unto you with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, men that have hazarded their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have sent therefore Judas and Silas, who shall also tell you the same things by mouth. What we are writing down, what we have discussed, and what we have decided upon, they will show you by mouth, with the word of their mouth. For it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things, that ye abstain from meats offered to idols, and from blood, and from being strangled, and from fornication, from which if ye keep yourselves, ye shall do well. Fare ye well. So when they were dismissed, they came to Antioch, and when they had gathered the multitude together, they delivered the epistle, which when they had read, they rejoiced for the consolation. You see, that's the word of God that they heard. And when they gave them that word of God, it made them to rejoice. It made them actually to go. That means then, the precepts were hearing from their quarters. The cases were receiving from their quarters. The videos and the materials and the literature were receiving from their quarters. And the decisions were receiving from their quarters. It gets to the states. It gets to the nations. And it gets to everywhere where Deeperlife Bible Church. The moment it gets to us, we'll accept, we'll embrace, because this is coming from our headquarters. And actually, that is what brings encouragement to the people of God. It brings edification to the church of God. It brings establishment to the church of God, and brings enlightenment to the church of God everywhere. If we are holding on to the same thing and believing the same thing and accepting the same word, that's what it does in the church. Number one, encouragement. You will see that as those things were read to the believers in that place, they were encouraged. Number two, edification. They were edified. They were built up. And they were strengthened in the faith and the love. Number three, establishment. That's how to establish the church. And you know, there are some people, there's a branch here, there's a branch there, there's a branch there. And this branch here is doing something different. The other branch there, their music is different. The other branch there, their doctrine is different. The other branch there, their Sunday school is different. And the headquarters, you know, the headquarters is going its own direction. And all the other branch churches are going their direction. That's not Bible. That's not according to the Word of God. In the Word of God, what comes from the headquarters gets to all the churches. Isn't it what happens in the body? The blood that circulates from the heart is being pumped to all the various parts of the body. Whether it's the hand, or the eyes, or the mouth, or the legs, or anywhere, is the same blood system that is passing through everywhere. The same thing as the headquarters in the heart. The word, the doctrine, the teaching, the practice, the music, everything coming from that headquarters will go over to all the body of Christ. Brings encouragement, brings edification, brings establishment, and it brings enlightenment of the church everywhere. And it should always be so. The benefit, what are the benefits? If we will do that, number one, there will be undiluted, unadulterated doctrine. If we follow this pattern of the New Testament, and we follow, they do something that what we are receiving from the headquarters, the teaching, the doctrine, the material, the cases, the literature, it goes everywhere. It's going to bring, number one, undiluted, unadulterated doctrine. Number two, it's going to bring unshakable decision. Unshakable decision. It means that the decisions we are taking at the headquarters and the decisions they are taking in all the other places will be unshaking, because the word of God will come again and strengthen the decisions that were took before. Number three, it will bring uncompromising discipleship. The people like Timothy, like Titus, like Tychicus, like all those people that are learning, they're learning from our overseers, they're learning from our pastors, they're learning from all those various places, the workers who are there, the leaders who are there, will have uncompromising discipleship. Number four, there'll be undiminished devotion. A devotion to the word of God will be undiminished. Our devotion to the Lord Himself will be undiminished. Our consecration, our surrenderedness, our yielding, our submission to the Lord will be undiminished. Number five, there will be unchallengeable defense. Unchallengeable defense. You see, the Word of God is our defense. And then it will be unchallengeable. The devil will not be able to challenge us. And false people that are preaching false doctrine, that is a false prophet, they will not be able to challenge us and defeat us. Because when that same word, the word, the sound word of God, earnestly contending for the faith, which was once delivered unto the saints, give, it brings unchallengeable defense. Number six, unlimited development. We will just be developing workers there, developing leaders there, developing men there, developing women there. It brings unlimited development. And then, number seven, it brings unhindered destiny. Unhindered destiny. The devil will not be able to hinder our destiny. Okay? Making it in this world, having all the blessings of God upon our lives here in the world, and also getting to heaven at last, will have unhindered destiny. One, undiluted, unadulterated doctrine. Number two, unshakable decision. Number three, uncompromising discipleship. Number four, undiminished devotion. Number five, unchallengeable defense. Number six, unlimited development. Number seven, unhindered destiny. United with Christ, will be rooted in His word, and then we shall remain inseparable with Christ's church, built upon the rock, against which the gates of hell shall never prevail. This is the kind of church the Lord actually wants to build, standing upon this truth, standing upon the word of God that can never be destroyed. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I pray that as you become part of the church that Christ is building, and the gates of hell cannot prevail against that church, I pray you remain in that church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against the church, and will not prevail against you in Jesus' name. And you will have part in this mandate. You'll have part in this ministry. You'll have part in establishing the church of the living God. Will you have a part in this? Will you have a hand in this? Is your life and family going to get involved in building and establishing this church that cannot be destroyed? And then you yourself, nothing will destroy you. Nothing will come against your life. And as we are together in wonderful fellowship here, on that final day, when the trumpet shall sound, we shall be in everlasting fellowship together, even with the Lord and with one another in heaven, in Jesus' name. You have put your hand on the plow, nothing will drive you back. Nothing will make you look back. You are part of the people of God. Nothing will remove you and throw you into the wilderness again. We're journeying together. We're going to succeed together. And the joy of the Lord will never leave our lives in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to them and say, Lord, I'm part of the people of God. I will never leave this house of God. I'll never leave the people of God. I'll never leave the church of God. I have made up my mind. I've taken my decision. This word of God that we are learning, I'm going to stay with the word of God. I will not allow anything to uproot me and to take me away from my place. My place will not be vacant in the church of God.